Welcome home. Welcome back. Let's tell you what we know who we are. And we can, where are they? That I found out. Good morning.
Morning.
You wanna hear a good word?
Yes.
Now listen up. Okay? Are you with me?
Amen.
Father God, I thank you. Lord, I thank you for the anointing. That anointing breaks burdens and destroys all the boundaries that we came in here with, Lord. We are attentive to your voice, Lord God. And we ask you now that you minister to each of your children in your special way, enlightening them, Lord, and giving them courage and strength to press on and go through and raise up the banner that Jesus Christ is alive and well.
Amen.
In Jesus' name,
amen.
I want to share this morning on something that happened to me a long time ago. And as I was praying, God began to show me how faithful he was over these 45 years of ministry. I want to share this morning, and I want each one of you to take it personally and to search your heart to see where God met you and see where he is about to bring you to the place that he has planned for you to fulfill your destiny.
Yes.
Each of us have a destiny that the Holy Spirit wants to empower us to go on, go through, and meet that destiny for his honor and his glory.
Amen.
Can you say amen this morning?
Amen.
God's healing mercies. God's healing mercies. It is what I'm trying to share with you this morning, that when we receive the power of the Holy Spirit, we are receiving God's healing mercies. It's not of works. It's not of anything else. Isaiah 64 said, our good works are like filthy rags. Not that he would like you to stop working after you get saved. In fact, the thermometer should go up and you should find yourself in a place where whatever you set your hand to will prosper.
Amen.
You know that we're accountable to God to set our hand to do the things that he has commanded us to do?
Yes.
You know that we're going to be accountable for the works that we do, but we're not healed by those works. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Have you got that?
Yes.
Many people have the wrong impression of who God truly is. The character of God. We may image him as someone mean, someone who is always just waiting for us to miss him. I used to think he was up in heaven with a baseball bat, just waiting for me to screw up. Well, I realized that it was my mom talking. And every time I would do something wrong, she'd say, God's going to punish you. God's going to punish you. So what was the idea I had of this man called God? I thought he was in heaven just waiting for me. Me. Not the rest of you. Just me. And waiting for me to screw up so we could let that baseball bat go down. I had the wrong impression of Christ. And if you turn to Psalm 145, I'm going to show you through the Word, because the Word has the power. The Word has the power to change your thinking. And when you begin to change your thinking, you'll be able to change your talking. Amen?
Amen.
Psalm 145 expresses the Lord is gracious, full of compassion, slow to anger, and of great mercy. The Lord is good to all, and to his tender mercies are over all his works. Ephesians 2:10 tells us that we are his workmanship, made unto good works. Are you his this morning? Or do you need to go back to the altar and say, God, I want to give this part that I've been holding on to. I want to give it to you because I know that only in you can I partake of his mercies. We're sitting here this morning and I'm looking and I'm thinking, oh my God, look where Michelle has come to. Glory to God! Glory! And I bet every one of you have a story just like hers. We need to share that testimony. And then I looked around and I saw someone else and I thought, wow, God, what you did in them. And then I looked around and I saw another and I saw another and I saw another. And beloved, it was his mercy.
Amen.
And when we were in a backslidden condition, when we were without hope, his mercy reached in and his compassion reached in.
Amen.
And brought us to a place where we are this morning. When you think of the mercy of God, when you think of the compassion of God, that's why we're sitting here this morning. Through all our defects, through all our mistakes, this mercy was ever reaching out and grabbing hold of us and trying to draw us back. Thank you, Jenna. And thank God we are open. And he was able to draw us back to the place where we could be ministered to so that we can then become ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Chucky, I can't help but look at you.
I can't help but look at you.
And the story that you and I have to talk about, right? God, that's God's mercy. But on the other side, I want to tell you something. I know that Debbie and I never stopped praying for you.
Thank you.
Never. We had this blessed hope that he belonged to God and God would bring him full term. And he went a little bit down. A little bit.
A couple months.
He went way down. And one day he's sitting in my office and I started to cry. And I knew, and I want you to know today, it was God's mercy, but prayer preceded the mercy. You understand that? The intercessor. God said he looked for an intercessor. You can find none. Oh, beloved, if you ever think of coming to intercessory prayer, that's where it is. That's the prayer that God hears. And that's the prayer that God answers. God is gracious, full of compassion, slow to anger, and great mercy to all. Say all means me. Say it. All means me. Because somehow we think, oh yes, he has mercy for everyone else, but he forgot me. But he didn't forget you. He never. He said that your name, look how personal God is. He said your name is written on the palm of his hand. Never let go of you. Never. until the last breath. In other words, God is saying to be merciful means to be full and overflowing, full of compassion. You know what I've seen in the years that I've been in ministry? I've seen people come to Christ and be full of love and full of compassion. And as the days went on and the disappointments came, we forgot that compassion. And we began to protect ourselves. We began to build walls. We began to let people go when we know we should be ministering. The only way that you can protect yourself from being hurt is being so full of the word that the hurt melts of the compassion and understanding of the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans, the 12th chapter, tells us, renew your mind daily to what I'm saying, so that you can present yourself as a good sacrifice, knowing the will of God for your life. You see, when we begin to get hurt and we begin to take on offense, we begin to build walls, and we're not only keeping people out, but we're keeping God out. We're keeping that mercy out. We're keeping that compassion out. God wants us to be full of compassion, as my Father is. I am made in the same image and likeness, and every day I am similar to my Daddy more and more as I follow His word. Do you understand that? I put offenses down, and I pray through them. Matthew 5 said, pray for those who despitefully use you, and do good to those who hurt you. That is the way that you get through the offenses. Don't ever have an offense. Build a wall, because, beloved, you're not keeping people out, you're keeping God out. Turn with me to 1 John 2, please. Oh, the word, it's so good. It is so good. It is health and medicine to your flesh. 1 John verse 2. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You know, it's been a long time since I've been up here. And actually, would you say, were you nervous, Pastor? You were saying, I got up and I prayed in the Spirit. I said, God, I'm prepared, but you better go with me. And I know that He is with me. Amen? Amen? That we don't ever get in a position where we have to count ourselves to do it, but count on the Holy Spirit in us to do it. Amen? So that when you say, oh, I can't do that, or I'll pray, and then I'll let you know if I'm going to do that, you're copping out. Because you can do all things through the Christ that strengthens us. And if you say that long enough and you begin to mean it, guess what you're going to do? All things through the Christ that strengthened us. 1 John 2 and verse 15. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. I stop because I want you to think of what I just said. It doesn't mean you have to be under the law, but it means you have to be aware of how much of the world we're letting in and what kind of a witness we are to others around us. Verse 16, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but it is of the world. And then He encourages us and tells us, and the world passes away and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever, has eternal life. You know, just because we said a prayer 15 years ago doesn't doesn't mean that we're going to enter heaven. It says those who endure will be saved. Endure what? Trials, tribulation, sickness, yes, and even death. Those who endure, because he gave us the power of the Holy Spirit that we're able to endure. What a good Father.
Amen.
What a good Father. Ephesians 4, 23 says that we should take off the old man, layer by layer, and put on the new man, which is in Christ. Beloved, I'm here to remind you this morning that you are a new creation, all things being past and all things being new and of God. We might slip, we might fall, we might go on a tornado ride, but God is always there. And all you have to do is come back to Him. 1 John said, if you say you don't sin, you're a liar. But if you sin and you repent, He draws you right back. We shouldn't be running away from Him and going out in the world. We should be running to Him so the world can get out of us.
Amen.
Are you following me? Born of the Spirit. Ezekiel tells us, I'm going to take out your heart of flesh, and I'm going to put in with you my heart. And I'm going to cause you, with my heart living in you, to walk circumspectly, the way I have ordained, so that you may fulfill your destiny. You see, beloved, what I'm trying to say is your life is more than what's happening today. Is your life is what's happening every day of your life. Are you a witness? Can you be a witness? Can you go up to the hospital room? Larry and I have such a good time now. We just enjoy one another. And he ministered to me, and I ministered to him. What a joy he is. Your husband is a real, compassionate, loving man. And I'm waiting for you to say real loud,
amen.
Amen.
For all their prayers for him.
Amen.
He's doing great.
You know, and we have so many people that have been taken with illness. We have been so many people that passed away. We have so many people in the rehab. Beloved, you should be going up there, and you should make time to visit them. I spent 3 months in the rehab when Pastor Don was there. And 3 months another time. And I thought that I was compassionate, and I thought I was loving. But it was a new day when I went up there. And there were things that I did that I would have never been able to do. I remember some of the men would dribble and spit up their food, and I would reach over by the grace of God and clean them up and wipe them off, because I had the conviction of the Holy Ghost that if I could do that for God, my husband, I could do it for anyone. And God sent me up there. And Pastor Mike, I know he keeps telling me I have an anointing for the rehabs. And I keep telling him that everybody has the anointing for the rehabs. I didn't hear him read me that. I'll say it again. Every one of you have the anointing to go up to the rehab and stop thinking of yourself and start thinking of others. Oh, that went over real good, Pastor. But you know, there's joy in that. I had so much joy because I kept leading these people to Christ. And that joy gave me the strength to minister to my husband and my children. Do you understand what I'm saying? I couldn't have done that. I could never have done the things that I did, but under the power of a living Christ and the Holy Spirit, I was able to shine the light. I remember when Nick, I don't know how many remember Nick, but I pray for him every day, and he's on his way back, even if he doesn't know it. Did you get that? Even if he doesn't know, he's on his way back.
Because
I'm never going to give up praying until he walks through these doors. But I remember him coming to me and saying, Pastor Lucy, my uncle's here. Oh, boy. And I go, what's he rejoicing, oh, boy? He says, well, you can minister to them. I said, well, why don't you minister to them? He said, oh, no, because you will be all this to him. And he set it up. He had everything, no place to know. And one day I ran right into this uncle. And he was like, what did I say, putty with my hands? And he got saved. Well, you see, beloved, I have an anointing. But I want you to say, and so do I. Raise your hand and say, and so do I. This side is much more so do I than that side. Let's try it again. And so do I. Amen, amen, and amen. Excuse me. If we're made in the image and likeness of God, that's what Genesis, the beginning of the book, tells us. Amen. So every day we're in the Word, every day we're hearing the Word, every day we're fellowshipping, we're getting more and more to look like our dad.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Do I hear an amen?
Amen.
When you walk in a room, who should be walking in that room?
Jesus.
Who?
Jesus.
Who?
Jesus.
Who?
Us.
Amen. Now you're getting it. Amen? I got you. I got you. It's on tape, by the way. Okay?
Oh.
It's on tape. Amen. Amen. Turn with me back to Ephesians, the fourth chapter. Taking off the old man. What are some of the things of the old man? Oh my. What are some of the things? We don't want to remember them. But sometimes it's good to just bring it back to our remembrance. Look who we came from. I could give Pastor Mark a microphone, but I would never get it back. But I know where he came from. He knows where he came from. And look at what God is doing, just using him as an example. Amen?
Amen.
He knocked on my door and he said to me, someone told me that you could deliver me from drugs. And I said, really? How come you missed Pastor Nam's door and you missed Pastor Frank's door and you knocked on my door? He said, because somebody told me you could do it. But it wasn't me. Who was it?
Jesus.
Who was it?
Jesus.
In me, the hope of glory. Got it? Stand up, Pastor Mark. And what do you got to say?
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. And what have we got to say? Thank you, Jesus, to Pastor Mark.
Amen.
And Pastor Frank and Pastor Mike and now Pastor Nancy. Thank you, Jesus. But you have a call on your life, too. I would be bold to say, right now, how many, and I'll close my eyes, okay, know after all these years of what the call of God is on your life? Because when you know the call, you have the purpose. And when you have the purpose, that's the engine that's making your life work. Without that purpose, you'll go up, you'll go down. I go to church, I'm tired. But do you have a purpose to which God called you to? Are you walking in that purpose that God has commanded us to walk? Are you there in Ephesians? I just want to read this to you. Are you hearing what God's speaking to us this morning? Thank you, Jesus. 4:23 in Ephesians says, put on a new man. Get rid of that old man. How do you put on a new man? By getting rid of the old man. Now, Ephesians 4. Putting away in verse 25, lying. Do you know some people have a spirit of lying? You ever meet anybody like that? And you can tell right away that they have that spirit. A spirit of lying. Speak every man truth to his neighbor. Are we working on that? Do you know what I found out? I found out sometimes when I'm in the middle of, oh my God, what am I going to do? And the Holy Spirit looks up at me and he says, speak the truth. You know what the Bible says? If you have an offense with anyone, go to the person that you have the offense with and tell them the truth. That is one of the biggest verses in the Bible that'll set you free.
Amen.
Instead of running and telling everybody else, you go right to the person. And you speak truth in the spirit of love, not out of anger. Because if you speak that truth out of anger, you lost the whole ballgame. Speaking the truth. Be angry and sin not. He's giving us a license to be angry. And most of us need that license. But he said, don't sin. Not. He said, don't let that sin take you to bed at night. Because you're going to wake up in the morning and have twice as much sin in your life. And you weren't going to be able to sleep either. Because you were tossing and turning, thinking what I'm going to say when I see them. Boy, oh boy. He said, you can be angry. But deal with it before you go to sleep at night. Let him who stole steal no more. You know what I was thinking? Oh my God. I worked for this beautiful, beautiful man as his pharmacist assistant. He was the most godly man I ever met in my whole life. And you know, I can't believe this. But the Holy Spirit had a hold of me the other night. And he said, remember when you took this? But I always had a good reason why I took it. Is there anybody else here who ever did that? Please don't let me be the only one. And I had to confess. This is 50 years, 60 years ago. 70 years ago. And the Holy Spirit cried, how could I have ever done that? But that was the old man. And that's why I'm asking you this morning to let God deal with us. Because we don't want anything. We're visualizing that purpose and that destiny that we're going to see God and answer. Are you getting this what I'm saying? Let no corrupt communication proceed out of the way which is good to use for edifying of the body of Christ, that it may minister grace to the hearer. I'm sure that we could go over these things, where we need to grow, and how we can overcome these shortcomings. And grieve, all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind one to another. Be kind one to another. Be kind one to another. Tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ has forgiven you. Be therefore followers of Christ as dear children, and walk in love as God hath loved us and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet, sweet smelling flavor. And he goes on and he goes on and he shows you what that old man was like, and he tells you how you could put that old man off and put that new man on. Remember, some people think that God's mercy was only there for us to get saved. And if each of you go back to the day that you were saved, you could see the mercy in that. I could see the mercy in that because I remember standing on the stairs, and the pastor at the time was a young boy, and he said to me, Mrs. Schipani, would you please play with me? And I thought to myself, if I don't pray with this jerk. That's what I said to myself. He'll never let me go. So I prayed the prayer. And it seemed like, so when I said it, I got off my back. Honestly, that was my whole concept of the whole thing. And yet, in God in His mercy, full of compassion, gets me up the following morning. I go upstairs in my attic. I get my big gap of Bible, opened it up. And it said, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He said, Lucy, you look for me all your life. I'm between these two pages. And something went off in my heart and changed my life. I went down 12 scriptures, and it said, you weren't born by the will of flesh, and you weren't born by the will of man. But you were born by the will of God. Right then, I got delivered from rejection. But all my dad kept telling me all my life, you weren't supposed to be born. We weren't supposed to have another baby. Your mother's dying because of you. For 25 years, I listened to that. You were an accident. What do you think I believed? I believed I was an accident. And God set me free. And I got such a hunger to know my real father because the world had painted a terrible picture of him. Religion had painted a terrible picture of our God and our Father. And I would get to know him because in between those pages was love and was compassion.
Amen.
And everything that I was looking for. It's more than salvation, beloved. It's walking in the abundant life. If you abide in him and the Word abides in you, you shall ask what you will, and it will be done for you by my Father, which is in heaven. That's called the abundant life. Don't give up.
Yes, thank you.
Don't ever quit.
Amen.
And don't be satisfied with, oh, he said a prayer 20 years ago, so he's saved. I question that salvation. I don't judge it, but I question it because the Word of God says those who endure the hardships will be saved. So you have to toss that around. Are you satisfied because your son said the prayer 20 years ago, but he's walking with the devil? I don't know about you, but I'm not. Are you satisfied that your daughter said the prayer? Your uncle said the prayer? I am going to fight until there's no fight when they close the casket. Then I'll give up. And I always said this. People said to me all those years, Pastor Lucy, how'd you do that? How'd you minister to those same people over and over and over and over? And I would always say, when God gives up on me, you're out of here. I feel it's pretty safe, right? Because I knew one thing for sure. My Father would never leave me, nor forsake me, nor ever let his hold at me.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. There's so many people in the past year that are in rehab. So many people have passed away. You know what I'm looking for? I'm looking for miracles. I'm not looking for healings. I'm looking for the miracle of healing. I remember my children saying to me, after I said that prayer, come on, Mom, we're going to the tabernacle tonight. Benny hits there, and you got a bad heart, and he can heal your heart. And I go, oh, here they go. And I tried everything I could out of giving to go. But I ended up on the fourth row at the tabernacle. And I'm wondering, what am I doing here? I'm a Catholic. I don't belong here. And my flesh is fighting my spirit. And Benny Hinn is up there. And he starts ministering. And all these negative thoughts are going through my head. And all of a sudden he starts praying. And all of a sudden, I stood to my feet. By the power of the Spirit, I never meant to stand to my feet. Honestly. And all of a sudden, I'm on the floor. Now, that's embarrassing for a Catholic.
Yeah.
I mean, we didn't know anything about this stuff. And Betty Ann said, bring that lady up here. And he said, what happened to you? I couldn't even talk. But I know what happened to me. I received a healing by God's mercy. Why? Because I didn't even know I could be healed. Come on, church. I want you to go back. I want you to think how you were stuck in a little church. They never told you God loved you. They never told you God would heal you. They never told you you have to say a prayer and invite him in your heart and be saved. Did they? Did they? Did they? But God healed me. And I got so on fire for God. And my daughter just said to me the other day when we were on vacation, she said, Mom, she said, I prayed you would get saved because I never thought that would happen. She said, but I didn't want you to be a pastor. I said, you should have taken it up with God. Come on, laugh, go ahead. Am I the happiest person in the world that I'm not only saved, but he chose me to shepherd his children? What an honor.
Amen.
What an honor.
Amen.
I look at President Trump and I go, oh man, you are something else again. Don't throw tomatoes at me if you don't like President Trump. And I'm not going to say any more, but my God, what fortitude, what discernment, what courage, what strength this man of God portrays every day of his life. He said, and let me repeat it again, okay? Those who endure the temptations, the sufferings, the persecutions, they will be saved. My God, when I think of that whole side, all the people that are in the nursing home, all the people that have met their up with their maker. Do you know that you're ready to go now? Do you understand that you have fulfilled your destiny? Do you believe that all those you love, you're going to meet in heaven? Let's look at the miracles for just a moment. See how God was moved with compassion towards suffering humanity. The man with the leprosy walked up to Jesus. And Jesus said, what do you want? He said to me, if you can, will you heal me? The definition of mercy, dear beloved, is a blessing that is an act of divine favor or compassion. In other words, compassion is mercy, which was motivated by Christ to heal that leper. Let me just explain this. That people think everything depends on the priest. Everything depends on the pastor, the mood of the church, the mood of the people. I'm here to tell you that there was such a tremendous anointing this morning. Who felt that anointing? Who felt it all over the auditorium? That anointing, beloved, in Isaiah, says that anointing will break and devour every bondage, every sickness, every problem. Come on, and it's up to you to enter into the praise and the thanksgiving, to bring forth an anointing so that man back there that walked in off the street could get healed and have a healing mercy. And God, it's your responsibility. It's not only my responsibility, and I'm hanging on you this morning, because, you know, I could go any minute. I don't plan to, but I want to leave you with some good word.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Psalm 145. Thank you, Lord. The Lord is good, and all of his tender mercies over all his works are there. He's talking to us this morning. If you came in here and you don't know two lines of the word, God can heal you.
Amen.
In fact, God has a better chance of healing you. Healing you without all the word that you might have in you.
True.
Because you've got to get out of his way.
Yes.
And beloved, you have to be consistent. What I mean by that is every time the doors of your church is open, you ought to be there on your face praying for yourself and your family and all the other people that are in your family, the family of God.
Amen.
Come on. You can't just come and say, well, here I am, and I pick out a scripture from the verse and say, God, you said in the word in Isaiah that by the stripes of Jesus I'm healed. I'm healed. And call me up 3 days later and say, yes, Lucy, I'm not healed. Is there something wrong with that? He wants a commitment. He wants you to do what you know to do. His mercy is always there. Listen. In the Old Testament, when they were challenged, what did they do? They sought the Lord. Hello. That's what my Bible said. They didn't run to the pastor and then the other pastor and then the other pastor. They didn't run to TBN. They sought the Lord. And when they praised him and worshiped him and thanked him, the anointing fell. And they could not stand up in the glory of the Lord. And that's what happened to me that day at the tabernacle. I stood up and I fell down. God said, I'll get her a place of humility. Believe me, that was a place of humility. The house was full of his glory. And the priests, you know who the priests are?
Yeah.
Who are the priests, Peter?
Yeah.
Yeah. Who?
We
are. Say it again.
We are.
This side, say it. Who are the priests?
We are.
Is it Pastor Frank's problem? Only? Is it Pastor Nancy's problem? Only? It's our problem. And I want you this morning to take ownership of that. Man, when I go to church Wednesday night, hallelujah, I'm going to be filled with the power of God, and I'm going to get there. I can't wait to get there and praise God and thank him for a beautiful Thanksgiving and I owe so many things I can thank you for, God. And then the anointing will fall. And then people can get out of wheelchairs like they did 40 years ago. I saw that. I saw the miracle of the church. And I'm encouraging you to bring that atmosphere back into the church that God called you to. Come on, church. We need to get busy. We need to commit. And we need to go about doing the works of God. We need to get up to those rehabs and let the light shine through us to them. Can you ever believe I spent 6 months in a rehab? I didn't want to ever spend one day, but I did, and I was the better for it. I'm a different person.
Amen.
And so could you be.
Yes.
I'm going to close with one thing. When I read this years ago, I was really moved with compassion. And in Matthew, it tells about when they cut off, was it Peter's head? And laid it on a plate and brought it. And Jesus, now just imagine someone close to you passing away. I mean, that's for eternity, right? And someone comes up to you and tells you, your daughter just passed away. Listen what happened next. He was so full of compassion that he went about healing all those who were ill. Most of us would have went to our bedroom and had to be drugged out to go visit the casket. Is that true? Because we get into such a self-pity. We get into thinking about nobody but ourselves. When they told him of Peter and us, he went about filled with compassion and healed all that were ill. I close. Father God, thank you. Thank you for being able to be filled with that same love and that same compassion, one for the other. I love God, Chucky. He did it all. He's got a beautiful wife, and God's turned her life right side up. And God wants to do it in our own lives, in our own families, and the family of God that God wants to be with. I thank you, Lord. That as the music ministry ministers, that you have spoken into our hearts, God. And Father, we want more. We want more of that love and that compassion. We want to think of others before we think of someone. Because God, while we're thinking and ministering to others, you're already taking care of all of our which we could never do. Let your Holy Spirit begin to touch. Let compassion begin to fill us. Let the love of God begin to fill us. It changes us. In Jesus' name. If the Holy Spirit is speaking to you, you need to come up, whether it's to recommit yourself, whether it's to get rid of that offense that you've been carrying around, whatever it is, you need to come to the altar, and you need to have a pastor pray, and that thing needs to be gone. In the powerful name of Jesus Christ, Lord, I praise you and I worship you, God, for your children, for the destiny that you have chosen for us. Lord, some of us have hearts that are hard because of earth. Lord, if they will step to the altar, you will melt this heart And you'll begin to let the love of God and the compassion of God begin to flow. Begin to flow. And the church will be on fire, God. The church will be on fire. And they'll be looking for signs and wonders and miracles, God. And people will come. And they'll meet their Savior. Lord, I just praise you. And I thank you. I thank you, Father. Oh, God, how I thank you. Praise you, Jesus. If you're thankful this morning, stand up and start praising him. And fill this room with the glory of God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. feel free to